is he?
In the dining room.
Bye.
Excuse me.
Don't try and look up my skirt.
God almighty.
thought we were going to have finger painting this afternoon.
Please, get off. Hello. The old cow. Oh, bloody hell. Cows were here before me.
Seems to be all right today.
Here we go. Look at that.
Right, Hardwell.
More to the right.
More to the right.
And more to the right.
Just more to the right.
More to the right.
More to the right.
Hello, Robert.
Okay.
Glad you found your way.
The instructions were perfect.
The village couldn't raise a team, so you're the scorer.
Why that?
I think they're a little frightened of our fast bowl.
I'm glad I'm scoring.
I think you'll have a very interesting time. You'll have a rather extraordinary companion.
Companion?
Yes, the other scorer. He's the most intelligent man in the place. I'll introduce you to him. Give him a bit of practice. His name is Charles Crossley. He's incredibly well-read. Claims to have travelled all over the world. And a genius of a mechanic. Keeps my old bike spinning along.
Your old motorbike?
Yeah.
Well, why is he here?
He's not entirely normal.
Oh, and what's normal?
See that tree over there?
Yes.
That's normal. See that one over there?
Yes.
Get your body behind it! Oh. No. Unfortunately, he believes that his soul is shattered into four pieces. Charles?
Yes, Doctor?
I want to introduce you to Robert.
How do you do?
He's your opposite number for this afternoon. Oh. Will you see that he's got a pencil and a note?
Why not? Yes.
Good luck.
Come inside. I rather like the doctor. Without a doubt, the most intelligent man in the place.
Right.
Well educated, well read, travelled, etc. Isn't that what he said?
More or less.
We're fielding!
Did he say that tree was mad?
Yes.
He's very repetitive.
How many patients have you got playing on your team?
I think five. The rest are all outsiders or members of the staff. That one over there is John Blake. He'll probably open the bowling. Played for England a couple of times. He's likely to bowl straight at the batsman's head. He's not really insane. He's just magnificently bad-tempered.
One, two, three, four in the slip.
Now, the doctor isn't a bad player, of course.
Where are the umpires?
Come on, girls!
Although he's not a startlingly innovative thinker. But he indulges me, for which I'm grateful, because, you see, I'm interested in his subject, psyche. And because I can read German and French and he can't, I can generally stay ahead of him.
Does he resent the competition, you studying his subject?
No, well, it's not really competition, is it? God helps those that help themselves, does he not?
Shit.
What's that umpire signalling?
Four leg bars, I think.
Anyway, I like to keep him happy. I make up dreams for him. I fill them with every significant symbol I can find. Fathers, snakes, apple pies.
That you suspect, yeah?
Anyway, I find it quite amusing.
Lovely!
Sorry, did you say something?
That man had a wife who loved him. A rare phenomenon, wouldn't you say?
Had? Well, what happened to her?
He lost her. I could tell you the rest of the story if you like. Do you think you can listen and score at the same time?
I'm sure I can.
We could make things easier for ourselves. You could keep both scores, and I could tell the story, and at the fall of each wicket, I could copy down what you've written.
We're very well organized, Mr. Crossley.
Every word of what I'm going to tell you is true. Only I'm telling it in a different way. It's always the same story. It's always the same story, but I change the sequence of events and I vary the climax a little because I like to keep it alive. You see, I like to keep it alive. Have you ever walked the sand dunes?
Terrible dream. I saw a man in the sand dunes.
Actually, it was round here. Running. And
he had a tail coat. A sort of old admiral's uniform.
Come on, girl, it's freezing.
He had something in his hand. That's funny. I've lost the buckle.
Rachel, come on.
Coming.
I'm afraid.
Oh, well,
you
better keep it.
Rachel!
Coming!
Did I tell you I was playing the organ tomorrow?
Yes, you did.
Do you want to come?
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I think. Can't do it, so I'm wondering.
Anthony, you're going to be late, love.
What?
Church.
Oh, Jesus.
You coming?
No, you're too late.
Church today. No. Well, that's fine, Harry.
Son, the Holy Ghost, Amen. We find ourselves living in disturbing times. The foundations of our society are not firm. We're like a rudderless ship. No direction. No one has any conviction anymore. You see, we don't believe anything. We are in a period of moral starvation. And it is during times such as these that our faith in Jesus Christ is the only thing that we have to hold on to. We must believe again. You see,
Panic.
Bloody kids.
Did you enjoy the sermon?
What? Oh, it's very good.
Yes? I've always found it hard to believe that the soul is imprisoned in the body until death liberates it. Don't you think that in periods of spiritual starvation that the soul might take refuge in a tree? Stone.
Come. I'll walk with you. We'll talk some more.
No, I'm afraid I can't, because my wife's waiting for me at home.
I've been on a walking holiday for a few days.
See.
Sorry I bothered you with that theological discussion. Your wife must be rather worried about you.
Yes, well, my bicycle broke down.
Oh, yes. Do you mind if I invite myself to lunch? We can continue our discussion. And I haven't eaten for 2 days, you see.
Really? Well, in that case, certainly, yes, of course. I mean, yes, and we'll continue our discussion over something to eat. You're Mr.
Crossley. Charles Crossley.
Right. Hello, love. What happened?
Sorry, I'm late, darling, but is this better? This is Mr. Crossley, he's come for lunch. Mr. Crossley, this is my wife, Rachel.
How nice. I think there should always be people there for Sunday lunch.
I must admit, I invited myself.
Well, you generally have to do that with Anthony. He just expects people to arrive, whether they've been invited or not.
Oh, what rubbish!
The many in church?
Usual crew of stalwarts.
How was the sermon?
Well,
standard Christian dogma. Religions all have to answer the same question.
What?
Has the human a soul? And if he has, where does he keep it?
Has the vicar any idea?
His belief is based on speculation.
Well, you can't base it on anything else, really, can you? Anyway, we've had this discussion before.
Anthony, why don't you ask Mr. Crossley if he'd like a glass of wine?
What do you think I'm doing?
No. I'd like a glass of water, please.
Oh.
That's very easy.
Is there anywhere that I can wash my hands before lunch?
Yes, there's a bathroom. Upstairs, along at the end of the corridor.
Thank you.
Where did you find him?
He found me when he came up to the end of the service and he started chattering about the sermon.
It's a bit overdone.
So is Mr. Crossley.
Please sit down.
It's easier if you help yourself.
Of course. Oh, please.
Must be hungrier than that if you haven't eaten for 2 days.
You must be starving.
I've been without food for much longer than 2 days.
Recently?
No, not recently.
But why?
I was travelling in the Australian outback. Food there was often in short supply.
How long were you living out there?
18 years, and in all that time, I never saw a white man.
18 years? Well, did you have an Aboriginal wife?
Yes, I did.
Children?
No. No children. None that survived, anyway. Under their law, either parent has the right to kill their offspring within a few weeks of birth. Always, I chose to exercise. I killed them because I knew that one day I would leave. And I knew that when I left, I would want to leave nothing behind. Does that shock you? That I admit to the killing of my children?
Since Anthony and I have not managed to have children.
Do you think you'll go back?
I'm sorry if I've upset your wife.
Now,
the killing of one's children is the only natural death in Aboriginal society. They believe that every other death is the result of either violence or some malevolent sorcery.
Sorcery, yes, well, I've heard of the pointing bone that they used to kill with.
Yes, that's the most common type of death magic.
Is it effective?
I've seen a man die within 3 days of learning that the bone has been pointing at him.
And who pointed the bone?
A magician he had wronged. Such a man could creep up behind you as you lay asleep, dip his hands into the small of your back, remove your kidneys, peel off the fat that surrounds them, and replace them without a scar. Death would be sure to follow in 2 or 3 days.
Interesting idea.
Once there was no rain for a whole year. The chief magician had been sent for. He was a genuinely terrifying figure, often parading in an old 18th century naval type officer's tailcoat. He cut his body with a sharp stone.
Where would he get hold of the tailcoat?
I'm sorry, I'm spoiling my lunch. I suffer from migraine. Can I lie down somewhere, please?
There's a sofa in the sitting room.
No, I think the spare room, he'd be more comfortable there. Move the chair down. Left of the bathroom.
Don't like your friend much.
Hardly my friend.
Anyway, say goodnight to him. I am going to bed.
Already?
Yep.
Anything wrong? You said that he cut himself with a stone.
He floated feathers in the air to represent clouds. Then he took a sharp stone and cut deep around his waist. Blood flowed like a waterfall. Then he tucked his fingers into the wound
dragged at his flesh, tearing it up across his chest, like a snake discarding his skin. It began to rain at that very moment. And it rained for 4 days.
I presume you believe in the power of their magic.
Oh, yes, I believe in its power. It's there. If a man is convinced he's going to die, he simply slips away and dies.
Mr. Crossley.
Don't patronize me with that tone, please.
That magician in the tailcoat gave me a terrible power over my enemies. He taught me the use of the terror shot. It took me 18 years to perfect it. Now I can kill with it. Kill. Instantly.
Yes, well, I find this all very interesting, but I think that 2 days without food have affected your mind very badly.
You haven't the imagination to understand anything outside your own experience. I've heard your music. It's nothing. It's empty.
Yes. Well, if there's anything you need before you leave, it'll be downstairs.
Very much like to hear your shout, Mr. Crossley.
I'm on my way now. Perhaps you'd like to walk with me for a bit. If I shouted for you now, you would die. As would your wife. And anyone else around here.
I don't believe in that shout of yours, Mr. Crossley.
I'll stay tonight. In the morning, we could walk on the dunes. There'll be no one about.
Well, it's fine with me.
You'd be wise to bring some wax or cotton wool to stop up your ears.
I want to be able to hear it. I have heard some sounds in my time, you know.
It will kill you then.
should be off.
Yes, well, wait me a second.
I'll wait for you outside.
Fine.
I bet I've got a stitch.
Put your fingers to your ears when you want me to stop. Not before I begin.
Thank you.
bees could do with some good new welts. Make sure that I get some beeswax and some hempin.
I'm not a shoemaker. I'm a musician.
Wonderful smell.
How are you this morning?
Well, I'm sorry Anthony left you this morning. He...
Oh, he got back all right then, didn't
he? Yes, he just wasn't feeling very well.
Are these cooked enough for you?
Oh, I'd like mine a little more, please.
Could you wash them? I think I'll go and see how Anthony is.
I think he may be asleep.
Well, I shan't wake him if he is.
So you took my advice. Wise of you. I thought perhaps I might help you in the garden or with whatever tasks you feel you can't escape.
Feeling any better?
What's Crossley doing down there?
Mending the bag. I'm going to the village.
Why'd you leave it?
I don't think he is.
God, why can't you get rid of him somehow?
He's perfectly harmless.
I don't give a damn how harmless you think he is. I just want him to go. You just tell him that he's overstayed his welcome.
Thank you.
I'm no master mechanic.
Did she get you home all right?
It's very sweet of you to take so much trouble.
How long will you be?
A couple of hours. Hour and a half, maybe. Thanks.
That was a splendid delivery.
The garden is wild. A virgin forest.
I like it this way. Shall I change it?
I didn't mean that you should.
I think that Anthony was jealous of you.
Are you happily married?
Possibly. What about you?
Could I have some sugar, please? Marriage in an Aboriginal society is different to what it is here. Oh, yes, it's true. If a young man wants a girl for his wife, he steals some trivial possession from her, casts a spell over it, and then she finds him irresistible.
Does it last?
Until death. Or until the husband leaves. Or until he deliberately relaxes the magic.
I'm so glad you felt well enough to come down.
Just thought I'd go for a short walk.
In the direction of the village.
Why?
My sandal needs mending.
Why didn't you take it in this morning?
Because I had other things to do.
Well, I'm not sure that I'm going to be going that far.
If I get it for you, you might just make the effort. Hey, Anthony. Oh, in a month, for all I care.
Well, he's got your buckle. I've seen him playing with it. Why don't you ask him for it?
Why?
Because I'm just about to go and buy another one, that's why.
Look, if he's got the buckle, he probably wants to keep it.
Don't be ridiculous, Rachel.
Oh, go on with you.
Go upstairs to my room.
Find me open today. I had a terrible turn this morning. Worst thing that ever happened in my life. Like someone was handling me. And that noise, like a terrible music. I was in bed, you know? I had this feeling all over me. First, like ripples under my skin. As though someone was skinning me from the inside. It was like he got his hand inside me and was pulling at my kidneys or my soul. And then as sudden as it come, it stopped. You know where I was? You know where I was? You know where I was? In the corner. And that music had stopped.
Look, do you think you could fix some, steel tips, not the Blakers, but the leather heel type with the leather filler. Well, look, why don't I do it? And then, well, then you can go home in them.
Love?
blade. Lem. Rachel. Rachel.
You're fabulous, Bert. Fabulous.
Let's get on with the game, shall we?
No! Oh! 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 Brave candle!
The umpire's decision is final. It's the weather, thunderstorm weather. It makes everyone here behave more irregularly than usual.
darling, will you run me a bath?
Here. Yeah, up here.
I don't know. I didn't ask.
Morning, Vicar. Hello, Mr. Fielding. I'm here to ask you a small favour.
Yes, what's that?
Harry, the shepherd, he died suddenly. And the organist is still away.
Harry died?
We need someone to play at the funeral service at 4.
When did he die?
Yesterday morning.
They found him on the dunes.
Yes, well, yes, in that case, yes, of course. Look, I'm sorry to talk to you like this.
It's all right. Goodbye.
Bye.
It's probably Crossley's.
I don't know why you let him bother you so much.
Thank you.
realize that we were expecting you.
No.
Sit down.
How long do you think you'll be able to stay?
Months rather than days. And when I've finished eating, Anthony, Rachel and I are going to bed. So you'd better make yourself scarce. You heard me.
Rachel, what's he talking about?
You heard him.
God's sake, Rachel! Get out of here, Anthony, or I'll shout your bloody ears off.
What's the matter? Have I done something wrong? All about.
Stupid bitch. Kill him, I'll kill him. I'll kill him. Go on. Kill him, I'll kill him. Tell him they're dead. Unless they leave. Dead. 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 I'll have to shout. I'll have to shout them dead. Gotcha.
Charles Crossley, I have a warrant for your arrest for the murder of your children.
No bloody fools! I have shot you dead!
Of course, Leanne. Of course.
Hold your position until you shower. Send somebody out to take care of it.
Crossley! Crossley! If you don't leave me alone, I'll punch you!